actually going. This one, the problem is, it just gets a bit, like if you take it higher up the neck, it gets a little bit sharp, it's not too bad.
Beautiful. Well, it doesn't take much, does it? Doesn't take long. Within a few seconds, the church is full, almost. Well, good morning, everyone, and just welcome again to Graceville Presbyterian Church. My name is Kanti. I'm going to lead the service this morning. Those of you who are on Zoom, welcome to you as well. I know you only have a very blurry version of me this morning, but that's temporary. Very soon you'll have 20/20 vision, but just a welcome. And look, if you're new here for the first time, just a couple of things here. Toilets are around the back of the building, outside. We've got another room here just behind this wall for parents with little ones. We've got sound and video there as well. We've got Sunday school also and Bible class around the back after the introduction of the service here this morning. Psalm 150 is a magnificent psalm, okay? We're going to sing about that in our opening service this morning. But it's the last psalm of all the psalms, yeah? And we're going to open our service with that psalm. Here's the words of that psalm that I'd like us to reflect on as we begin our service of worship before the Lord. Let's hear the words of the psalmist, shall we? Praise the Lord. Praise God in his sanctuary. Praise him in his mighty heavens. Praise him for the acts of power. Praise him for his surpassing greatness. Praise him with the sounding of the trumpet. Praise him with the harp and the lyre. Praise him with timbrel and dancing. Praise him with the strings and pipe. Praise him with the clash of cymbals. Praise him with resounding cymbals. Let everything that has breath praise the Lord. We're going to sing a new song this morning, and our musos are going to lead us with that song. But let's open in a word of prayer, shall we? Our loving Father, we want to thank you for the words of the psalmist that reminds us with the beautiful words of praise and adoration of the God that is not only awesome, not only in control, but a God who loves us and who deserves all the praise. And let all creation and everything on earth praise his name. Help us to worship. Help us to praise you this morning. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's stand and sing, shall we?
Hey, there we go. This one's a new song for us. Please join in as you feel comfortable. Made the starry host, you trace the mountain peaks, you paint the evening skies with wonder. The earth, it is your throne, from desert to the sea, all nature testifies your splendor. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord. Sing His greatness, all creation. Praise the Lord, raise your voice, you heights and all you depths, from furthest east to west, let everything that has breath praise the Lord. You reached into the dust, in love your spirit breathed. You formed us in your very likeness, to know your wondrous works, to tell your mighty deeds, to join the everlasting chorus. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord. Sing His greatness, all creation. Praise the Lord, raise your voice, you heights and all you depths, from furthest east to west, let everything that has breath praise the Lord. Let symphonies resound, let drums and choirs ring out, all heaven hear the sound of worship. Let every nation bring its honors to the King, a roar of harmonies eternal. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord. Sing His greatness, all creation. Praise the Lord, raise your voice, you heights and all you depths, from furthest east to west, you distant burning stars, all creatures near and far, from sky to sea to shore, sing out forevermore. Let everything that has breath praise the Lord.
I think that was a great song. That was all right. So next song is following on that. This is Amazing Grace, isn't it? Beautiful.
Love is mighty and so much stronger. The King of glory, the King above all kings, who shakes the whole earth with holy thunder and leaves us breathless in awe and wonder. The King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. You laid down your life. That I would be set free. Brings our chaos back into order. She makes me a son and daughter, the King of glory, the King of glory, who rules the nations with truth and justice, shines like the sun in all of its brilliance, the King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love, that she would take my place, that she would bear my cross. You laid down your life that I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. Slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy. Worthy, worthy, this is amazing grace. This is unfailing love, that she would take my place, that she would bear my cross. You laid down your life that I would be set free. You've done for me.
Amen. Father God, we want to thank you that this is such an amazing grace. Amazing grace that you've called us to be your sons and daughters. And what a privilege to just sing and dance before you and echo those words. Amen. Please be seated and all the children come forward. We've got 8 children's talk for you.
I think we're just heading straight out to kids' church by the looks of it. I'm not sure who's on, but okay, so kids, we're going to head outside for kids' church and I'm going to play a video or something for our kids' talk. Okay.
Good morning, everyone. Good to see you. My name's Rohan, if I haven't met you. Apologies for the mix-up there, but our kids will go out and continue learning out there. We'll just have to miss out on their exciting kids' talk today, unfortunately. My name's Rohan, if I haven't met you. Welcome to Graceville Presbyterian Church. It's wonderful to have you with us this morning. We're going to be continuing our series through the book of Exodus later on, and so looking forward to getting into chapters 7 to 10 this morning. And just a couple of announcements of what's happening around the life of our church to keep you in the loop. So today, after our 10:30 service, we'll be having a congregational meeting. So that's happening from 12 o'clock, if you're able to come back and make it along for that. The purpose of this meeting is to approve the appointment of a short-term youth leader over at Maruka. So Maruka is our other congregation, and they've had a young man by the name of Simon Nugent who's been studying at Theological College. He's finished his studies at college, but that means he has to finish his appointment as well because the appointment is linked to his studies. And so we've got to kind of come up with a new arrangement to get him through the rest of the year because we want him to continue to serve in that role for the rest of this year. And so if you could come along and join us for 12 o'clock, we'll be voting on that issue. And also we'll just use it as an opportunity to give you an update about what's happening with our building plans as a church, where our finances are at with that, and also a couple of other matters, staffing plans we've got in mind for next year, and also the PCQ receivership. And so if you're able to make it along 12 o'clock today, that would be great. Right. The other thing just to mention, we've been talking about the Grow Women's Conference. The registrations for that have now closed, but we have something coming up for the men in a few weeks' time. So on Saturday the 10th of September, I'll just get the details, Saturday the 10th of September at 7:30 a.m. here at church, we're going to have a men's breakfast. And we've got a special guest who's been invited to share with us, Dave Pitt, who works with the City Bible Forum. And so we're looking forward to Dave sharing with us that morning. City Bible Forum do great work empowering Christians to share their faith in the workplace, and particularly around the CBD of Brisbane and other cities in Australia. So it'd be a great opportunity for the guys to get together, enjoy a relaxed breakfast and time of fellowship with one another, and to hear from Dave Pitt. So that'll be 7:30 a.m. on the 10th of September. In terms of our giving here at Graceville, like I say, I'll give a full update later on at the congregational meeting. But in terms of the building fund, we have much to give thanks for. We're up to now, I think around $55,000 has been given to the building fund, which has enabled us to go ahead with the demountable purchase. And there'll be some other things in the pipeline I'll talk about later on. But we really give thanks to God for his generosity in that sense, through the gifts of his people. The area that we're struggling a little bit on this year is our regular giving. So we're behind budget this past month. So I'm going to pray to God, giving thanks for his provision and asking that he would continue to provide for our needs. Please join me. Heavenly Father, we give you thanks for your blessing to us as a church in so many ways. We thank you for the Lord Jesus who unites us together as your people from all different walks of life, and yet together we're one in Christ. And Father, we thank you for the way that you've provided for our needs over and over again through the years as a church. We look out the backyard, and while it's still a work in progress, we give you thanks that we've got more space out there to share the gospel with kids each Sunday and to see them grow in their love and knowledge of the Lord Jesus. We pray you'd help us to use these resources to your honour and glory, to help people to know you better. And we give you thanks so much for this gift you've given us in the demountable. We continue to ask for your provision, both in the ongoing work needed on the property here, and also, Lord, through our regular giving that goes towards the maintenance of these buildings, the salaries of staff that serve the cause of your gospel here, and other needs that we have as a church as we seek to reach our community with the good news of Jesus. And we ask for your wisdom to use these things for your glory and honour. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. We're going to continue now in a time of prayer. Thanks, Jamie.
Morning, everyone. How great is our awesome God who promises never to leave us nor forsake us. Let's pray. Just opening with a few words from Isaiah 43. You are my witnesses, declares the Lord, and my servant whom I have chosen, so that you may know and believe me and understand that I am he. Before me no God was formed, nor will there be one after me. I, even I, am the Lord, and apart from me there is no Savior. I have revealed and saved and proclaimed, I am not some foreign God among you. You are my witnesses, declares the Lord, that I am God. Yes, and from ancient days I am he. No one can deliver out of my hand. When I act, who can reverse it? Sovereign Lord, thank you for the way that you have revealed yourself to us throughout history, through your creation and mighty deeds, through your prophets, your word, and most personally and sacrificially, through your one and only Son, the Lord Jesus Christ. Thank you, Lord, that your perfect faithfulness and character is unchanging. Lord, please help us to remember your mighty deeds when our faith is weak, and to trust in your promises when facing obstacles or tasks that would overwhelm us. Lord, help us in times of trouble, ill health, unemployment, suffering, or trials of any kind, even when we feel down with the world as it is in these times. Let us take comfort from the fact that you are the Lord God who provides for us, sustains us, and who acted to deliver us from the ultimate judgment to come. Thank you, Lord Jesus, for rescuing us from our sins. Help each of us to bring our situations and circumstances before you each day as you care for us. Grant us patience and strength. Help us to trust in the sufficiency of your grace and mercy. Lord, we are sorry for our endless cycle of sin and rebellion against you, for our selfish living, not putting you first in favor of other things, not loving one another or our neighbor as ourselves as you command us. We repent of it, Lord, and desperately ask that you would change the desires of our hearts to live for you, a thing that we cannot do on our own strength. But as the Lord Jesus once said to his disciples, with man this is impossible, but with God all things are possible. Merciful Father, we remember our prayers at the beginning of the year here at Graceville. And we ask again today that you would draw our local community to church, that we would see new people come to faith in the Lord Jesus Christ, that you would use us as a church to welcome, encourage, and nurture one another in the faith. Lord, for many of us, we were once that person encountering the love of Christ for the first time, and we will be thanking and praising you for all eternity with joyful hearts. Lord, for your name's sake, we pray that we would see and hear of your amazing grace at work in the lives of others for the first time. Lord, we give thanks for the way that you provide for us at Graceville, for our ministry team, pastor, elders, kids' church leaders, musos, committee of management, our treasurer, for all who serve and give their time and finances sacrificially, for our growth group leaders, Tots and Tunes leaders, and those who serve the needs of our elderly. Lord, help us to be joyful, willing servants, productive and effective for the gospel as we patiently await Christ's return, looking forward to the day when all things are made new. No more tears, sickness, death, mourning, or suffering, when we get to live with Jesus, our Lord and Savior, in perfect glory, joy, and peace. In Jesus' name, amen.
Just as the musicians come forward and lead us in our next song here, Crown Him. This is a wonderful song that just reminds us of the fact that we come before God with nothing. You know, there's nothing in our righteousness, there's nothing we can do to earn our salvation, nothing whatsoever. You know, we come with empty hands, we come with sin in our hands, we come bringing nothing. So the result of that, and looking at everything that Jesus has done to bring us where we are, you know, we want to crown him King of Kings, King of Glory. So let's sing those words, shall we?
Let's stand.
It's not my righteousness. not my faithfulness. All I have is His for all eternity. We will crown Him.
This morning is from Exodus chapter 9, verses 13 to 35. Then the Lord said to Moses, "Get up early in the morning, confront Pharaoh and say to him, 'This is what the Lord of the God of Hebrews says, let my people go so that they may worship me, or this time I will send the full force of my plagues against you and against your officials and your people, so that you may know there is no one like me in all the earth. For by now I could have stretched out my hand and struck you and your people with a plague that would have wiped you off the earth. But I have raised you up for this very purpose, that I might show you my power and that my name might be proclaimed in all the earth. You still set yourself against my people and will not let them go. Therefore, at this time tomorrow, I will send the worst hailstorm that has ever fallen on Egypt from the day it was founded till now. Give an order now to bring your livestock and everything you have in the field to a place of shelter, because the hail will fall on every person and animal that has not been brought in and is still out in the field, and they will die.' Those officials of Pharaoh who feared the word of the Lord hurried to bring their slaves and their livestock inside. But those who ignored the word of the Lord left their slaves and livestock in the field. Then the Lord said to Moses, 'Stretch out your hand towards the sky so that hail will fall all over Egypt, on people and animals and on everything growing in the fields of Egypt.' When Moses stretched out his staff towards the sky, the Lord sent thunder and hail and lightning flashed down to the ground. So the Lord rained hail on the land of Egypt. Hail fell and lightning flashed back and forth. It was the worst storm in all the land of Egypt since it had become a nation. Throughout Egypt, hail struck everything in the fields, both people and animals. It beat down on everything growing in the fields and stripped every tree. The only place it did not hail was the land of Goshen, where the Israelites were. Then Pharaoh summoned Moses and Aaron. "This time I have sinned," he said to them. "The Lord is in the right, and I and my people are in the wrong. Pray to the Lord, for we have had enough thunder and hail. I will let you go. You don't have to stay any longer." Moses replied, "When I have gone out of the city, I will spread out my hands in prayer to the Lord. The thunder will stop, and there will be no more hail. So you may know that the earth is the Lord's. But I know that you and your officials still do not fear the Lord God." The flax and barley were destroyed, since the barley had headed and the flax was in bloom. The wheat and spelt, however, were not destroyed because they ripened later. Then Moses left Pharaoh and went out of the city. He spread out his hands toward the Lord, and the thunder and hail stopped, and the rain no longer poured down on the land. When Pharaoh saw that the rain and hail and thunder had stopped, he sinned again. He and his officials hardened their hearts. So Pharaoh's heart was hard, and he would not let the Israelites go, just as the Lord had said through Moses.
Thanks for reading, Joan. Let's pray as we spend this time before the Lord in his word. Heavenly Father, we want to thank you for your word and for this challenging passage that confronts us with who you are. We pray this morning that you would humble us, each one of us, before you, that we would live our lives rightly under your rule. And we pray this all for the glory of your name. Amen. Well, many of you know I'm a big cricket fan, and in my lifetime, probably the most monumental series that I've witnessed was the 2005 Ashes series between Australia and England over in England. And it was a series that was sadly won by England, but it was Australia, one of the best Australian teams ever, up against the English. And so Australia lost in 2005. Come 2007, it was time for revenge. And we had the Poms in our own backyard this time. And there was a huge hype going into the series. Could Australia bounce back and kind of show England who boss was? And the first test was here in Brisbane at the Gabba. I wasn't here then, but it was here in Brisbane. And England's main fast bowler, Steve Harmison, bowled the first delivery of the series. And if you're a cricket fan, you remember it slipped out of his hand and landed about where I put the red ball dot there. Nowhere near the pitch. It was caught by the guy kind of two along there. And it was an embarrassing start to the whole series that kind of set the tone of what would follow for the rest of the summer. By the end of the summer, England had been entirely humiliated. They'd lost 5-0. And Australia had well and truly shown their dominance as the best cricket team in the world. An absolute embarrassment to the visitors. They barely even put up a contest as Aussie's heroes dominated this series. Now, if you're not a cricket fan, sorry, I couldn't help but resist that, but hopefully you get my drift. You get this idea of a totally uneven contest, a completely mismatched showdown between two powers. And really, in this case, it showed the superiority of the Aussies and much greater than their opponents. That's the nature of the kind of one-sided battle that we find in our passage this morning from Exodus, except it's on a monumental scale. Much of what we've seen so far in this book has been building hype for this moment. Exodus opened with the ruthless and the violent oppression of God's chosen people Israel by Pharaoh, the Egyptian leader. And last week, we saw Callum was teaching us about how Pharaoh was ramping up his evil, So he'd started originally at the start of the book with forced labor and then with murdering all the Hebrew boys. And now this labor regime was ramping up. They were given insufficient resources to do the job. They couldn't have the straw anymore, but they still had to produce the same number of bricks. And when we look at this, I mean, Pharaoh, he seems like a powerful and intimidating ruler. But when we get to this chapter, we see, you know, wait till he's up, till we know who he's up against. Wait till we see his opponent, not the Israelite people, but the God who they serve, the God who has graciously revealed himself as Yahweh, I am. Yahweh who sees and who hears and who knows their suffering, who remains thoroughly committed to keeping his promises to bless them as a nation and bring them out of slavery into their own land to live in prosperity. So far in the story, Yahweh has raised up Moses and Aaron to lead them out of Egypt. And despite Israel's flaky faith, we saw last week they were doubting at the first sign of trouble, he's now finally about to kick off his rescue mission. That's where we're up to in the story. The hype is over. The showdown is ready to get underway. And we'll see this morning what an absolutely mismatched contest it is between Yahweh, the God who rules the world, and this Pharaoh who foolishly thinks that he does. Now, what we're going to do, we'll work our way through the narrative. We're covering a lot of ground, chapters 7 through 10. Joan just read a small part of that. So we'll give a bit of a helicopter overview of what's going on, and then we'll think about how it applies to each of us. Things kick off in chapter 7 with something a bit like Steve Harmison's wide. It indicates that already this match, we know which way it's going to go. God gives Aaron the ability to change his staff into a snake. And there's a bit of symbolism going on here. The snake was the symbol of the Egyptian power and their gods. And in biblical terms, I think it's also associated with the serpent back in Genesis 3 in the Garden of Eden, the one who tempted Adam and Eve to disobey God and ignore his rule. There's a sense in which the evil of Pharaoh and Egypt has a kind of evil spiritual dimension to it. And we see that from the horrific murder that takes place from the start of the book. And also when we see God's judgment come, as we look next week at chapter 12, it's framed not only as being against Pharaoh and against Egypt, but also against the gods of Egypt. Here in chapter 7, as a show of his supposed spiritual power, Pharaoh's magicians seem to be able to do the same thing. They can throw down their staffs as well. Except they would have been embarrassed because Aaron's staff comes and gobbles all of their staff snakes up. And so again, it's an indicator of who's really in control here. Pharaoh's response, it's consistent with what we see after each of the plagues through this section. He hardens his heart. He refuses to listen to Moses and Aaron. And in that respect, he's refusing to listen to God. And so begins the famous 10 plagues which God strikes Egypt with in response to their evil actions and Pharaoh's hard-heartedness. If you grew up in church, maybe you remember these from Sunday school, or maybe you've seen some of the movies like the Ten Commandments or the Prince of Egypt that have been made about the drama that plays out here. And I must say, as I reflected on this part of Scripture this week, I was really struck by how intense they are. I mean, it's not just a kind of magic show to entertain kids. These plagues, they cause serious destruction. They cause it across the land. They put Pharaoh in his place. If we're going to understand rightly what's going on here, we want to be clear, what is God's purpose in bringing these plagues on Pharaoh and Egypt? And thankfully, Yahweh is entirely transparent about what he's doing. What's his purpose? It's stated repeatedly through these chapters. And that is to reveal his power and his might to Egypt so that they would know who he is. For example, when the first plague happens and the Nile River is turned to blood in chapter 7, verse 17, it says this. This is what the Lord says. By this you will know that I am the Lord. With the staff that is in my hand, I will strike the water of the Nile and it will be changed into blood. And we get a more detailed version of this purpose statement in what Joan read for us in chapter 9 about the hail plague. Then the Lord said to Moses, get up early in the morning, confront Pharaoh and say to him, this is what the Lord, the God of the Hebrews, says. Let my people go so that they may worship me. or this time I will send the full force of my plagues against you and against your officials and your people, so you may know that there is no one like me in all the earth. For by now I could have stretched out my hand and struck you and your people with a plague that would have wiped you off the earth. But I've raised you up for this very purpose, that I might show you my power and that my name might be proclaimed in all the earth. So it's Yahweh's stated purpose to make himself known to Pharaoh, this Pharaoh who thinks that he runs the world, who thinks of himself like a god. Yahweh is rightly jealous for his own glory that Pharaoh has mocked. Remember back in chapter 5, verse 2, who is this Yahweh that I should obey him? I don't know Yahweh and I won't let his people go. Now, I think many of us react to this picture of God here with some degree of discomfort. A God who goes to such extraordinary lengths to pursue his own glory. I mean, let's be honest, if this was a politician, we wouldn't be voting for them, would we? If he was a human, we'd think he's a megalomaniac, a dangerous narcissist. But contrary to the deluded egos of people like Pharaoh, God does actually run the world. And because we humans were created to exist for his honour, Yahweh acting for his glory is actually the best thing for our world. It means dealing justly with evil, like this Egyptian regime, in the fierce judgment that it deserves. And it also means the gracious salvation of God's people. When they trust Yahweh and his actions for his glory, they will be liberated. Liberated so that they would rightly worship Yahweh. I should say, when I talk about Yahweh, we've spoken the last few weeks, it's whenever it's capital L-O-R-D in the Bible, that's God's name, his special name he gave to his people Israel. And he promises them that they'll come out and they'll worship him in the desert and one day enjoy the blessings that he's promised them. So Yahweh acting for his glory in both judgment and salvation, it's not only right, it's also good. It's how this world was made to operate. And so he tells Pharaoh here in these plagues, I'm doing this so you'll know who I am. I run the world, not you, buddy. I have supreme power. I'm the boss. And that's something we all need to know, so we're put in our place as well under him. That's the purpose of these plagues, that you may know that I am the Lord. Second thing I want to point out about these plagues is they're brought out for us in a really structured kind of narrative. It's a set pattern. In each case where there's a plague, you get a warning first. And so Yahweh calls Moses to go to Pharaoh and tell him, let my people go so that they will worship me. And if not, I'm going to bring a terrible plague so that you know that I'm the Lord. So you get the warning first. And then secondly, the plague actually arrives, just as God says it will happen. And there's terrible destruction across the land. For example, we get that horror description from our reading in chapter 9 of what happened when the hail came. When Moses stretched out his staff toward the sky, the Lord sent thunder and hail and lightning flashed to the ground. So the Lord rained hail on the land of Egypt. Hail fell and lightning flashed back and forward. It was the worst storm in all the land of Egypt since it had become a nation. Throughout Egypt, hail struck everything in the fields, both people and animals. It beat down everything growing in the fields and stripped every tree. Like every one of these plagues, the impact is frightening. A few years ago, I remember our family was doing a road trip to Sydney. We go down a few times each year to see family down there. 12 hours in our Kia Carnival with small kids in the back. It was good fun and we'd been making pretty good progress until about 45 minutes out from Sydney, one of the biggest hailstorms I've ever been in hit our car. In fact, it hit all the cars that were on the freeway and there was really nowhere we could go. Some were trying to get in under bridges and reserve the few spots that were left there. Some were trying to pull over. I'm sure there were accidents that took place. We could barely see a thing, and all we could do was sit in our car and hear this deafening noise beating down on our roof. I must say the damage was pretty severe afterwards. We had to get that all fixed up by the insurance company. Even in a metal car, you didn't seem safe when the hail struck. So you can imagine what it would have been like in ancient Egypt, getting this worst storm in its history that brings death on those who foolishly stayed outside and ignored the warning. What we notice is these plagues become more and more severe in their impact. But as that happens, Yahweh makes a clear distinction, a distinction between the Israelites, who he's promised to bless, and the Egyptians in chapter 9, verse 26. And the only place it did not hail was in the land of Goshen, where the Israelites were. And that's often the case in the last few plagues. So we have the warning, we've got the plague itself, and then finally, after each plague, the text highlights Pharaoh's response, which is to harden his heart, where he refuses to yield to Yahweh's request and to let the Israelites go. Even when towards the end, he seems to be more open to them going to the desert to worship, where he sort of looks like he's finally going to relent, then he wants to put conditions on it. He says, yes, you can go, but you can only take the men, not the women and children. Or yes, you can go, but you can't take your livestock with you. He even looks like he repents, as we had in our reading. He says, I'm sorry, I've done the wrong thing, but it's a sham. 5 minutes later, he changes his mind and refuses to let them go. So Exodus 9, Pharaoh summoned Moses and Aaron. This time I've sinned, he said to them. The Lord is in the right, and I and my people are in the wrong. Pray to the Lord, for we've had enough thunder and hail. I'll let you go, you don't have to stay any longer. Then Moses left Pharaoh, just a few verses down, and went out of the city. He spread his hands toward the Lord. The thunder and the hail stopped. The rain no longer poured down on the land. When Pharaoh saw that the rain and the hail and thunder had stopped, he sinned again. He and his officials hardened their hearts. So Pharaoh's heart was hard, and he would not let the Israelites go, just as he had said through Moses. Just as the Lord had said through Moses. What we see of Pharaoh here is kind of, I imagine, like a toddler having a temper tantrum. He just seems completely refusing to give in. He won't do it, but it's totally irrational, isn't it? You feel like he just needs his mum to go and give him 10 minutes on the wall to calm him down so he sees some sense. And then he might think about the situation they're really in, and he could do what is best for everyone and give up his fight. He's never really going to win that fight, is he? But even the officials, even they can see that these plagues are completely destroying their nation. They plead with him to do what Moses says. For example, in chapter 10, verse 7, after the warning about the locusts, Pharaoh's officials said to him, "How long will this man be a snare to us? Let the people go so they may worship the Lord their God. Do you not realize that Egypt is ruined?" But Pharaoh's refusal to yield, even in the face of obvious defeat, well, it's more than just a bad temper. It's a spiritual problem of hardening his heart. It's kind of putting his fingers in his ears and refusing to listen to God in an act of rebellion. It's what the Bible calls sin. And every one of us are guilty of sin. We want to do life our own way. We want to gain glory for ourselves rather than give it to God. In Pharaoh's case, it causes him to do great damage and evil to others. And yet it's not like the evil of Pharaoh is somehow beyond God's control. Even as Pharaoh hardens his heart against God, we're also told that God hardens Pharaoh's heart. So somehow, without compromising his justice, because Pharaoh clearly deserves what he gets, God allows Pharaoh to continue in his foolish rebellion, even though it's self-destructive. It's kind of hard for us as human beings with limited minds to get our heads around this, but it's something the Bible clearly teaches, that while God is never the author of evil, he maintains control over it and is able to use it to achieve his purposes. And the classic example of that is Jesus' death on the cross. While it was the same time the wicked scheme of men, it was the plan of God to save the world, both at the same time. You can ask me about that more later if you want. But we've seen the purpose, we've seen the pattern of this narrative. What about the impact? Well, actually, I think the pattern helps us appreciate the impact. I listened to a great podcast this week from the Bible Project, and it helped me come to grips with how the narrative is kind of an anti-story of the creation story back in Genesis 1 to 3. See, the plagues, they come in three sets of threes. Each one begins in the morning as Moses goes out to Pharaoh. And in many cases, there's a sense of undoing God's good gift of creation. We see language and images that would be very familiar to the original Israelite audience who were familiar with Genesis 1 to 3. So, for example, it begins with the blood plague, And the River Nile, that was the life source of Egypt. And yet it's filled with a stench of death, life to death. And this is really in response to what the original Pharaoh had done. He had turned this source of God's gift of life to Egypt into a place of death as all the baby Hebrew boys were thrown in there. Next, it's the frogs and the gnats and the flies that are teeming and swarming everywhere all over the land. And this is a bit like the living creatures that God made to teem over the land and out of the streams back in Genesis. Except now it's causing destruction and chaos. Then you've got the destruction of human life and animal life, the decay of bodies with the livestock and the boils and the hailstorm plagues. Just as God made man out of the dust and gave him life, here the dust turns to disease. Like the flood, God uses the weather to bring destruction in judgment of sin. And then there's the locusts that devour all the fruit of the crops. Nothing green is left on any tree, in contrast to the Garden of Eden, where God provided for all the fruit and food they needed. And then while creation began with God creating light, well, the ninth plague is darkness covering over the land. And we can't help but think of the darkness which covered the land when our sin was judged at the cross of Christ. The Exodus plagues, they're a story of decreation, as God brings judgment on evil and he shows Pharaoh what sin deserves. The withdrawal of God's blessings and God's gifts in the world that he's made. And so all Egypt might know Yahweh, that he alone is the Lord, that he alone is the one with true power. In the past few years with bushfires and pandemics and floods, I think we have some sense of what the severe impact of these plagues must have been like, one after the other and then the next one. Our sense of confidence in the basics of life, in our health and our safety, we feel like they've been undermined, haven't we? We struggle to cope with much more like this, of natural disasters and other things going wrong. It puts us in our place, makes us see how much we're not in control of our lives and that we're really not the boss of our own world, let alone the rest of what happens around us. And we've been reminded as Christians, hopefully, to not take these things for granted, to be thankful to God for his daily care and his gifts amidst the harsh brokenness of our world. And so for Egypt, just one of these nine plagues, well, that would have been terrible. And the worst is yet to come. We'll see that next week in the plague of the firstborn son. But for now, what are the takeaway lessons for us as we see the devastation that God brings in this ancient time on Pharaoh and the Egyptians? I think the main lesson for all of us is the same as God's purpose for Pharaoh. This part of the Bible is here so that we may know who the Lord is, that we would see that Yahweh is the only one who runs the world, and he does so with total and supreme power over everyone and everything. He alone is boss of the universe. And even the greatest earthly power of the ancient world, well, he's rendered a laughingstock in this mismatched showdown between God and Pharaoh. What does this mean for our lives, that God alone is ruler of the world? Well, I want to leave us with three necessary responses. Firstly, we each need to repent of our Pharaoh-like rebellion. The word repentance in the Bible is the idea of turning around, turning from living for ourselves and beginning to live for God's glory. In Exodus 7 to 10, God confronts the evil and the pride of Pharaoh, puts him in his place. The Bible says it's not just Pharaoh with this problem of rebellion. All have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. We all have this same unyielding heart that wants to ignore the Creator's wisdom for life because we foolishly think we can do it better on our own. Just as these plagues put Pharaoh in his place, they should do the same for us. It's completely irrational to think we can just shake our fists against the God who runs the universe, go on disobeying him with no consequences. It's self-destructive because we as his creatures were made to glorify him, enjoying life under his rule. Sin corrodes our relationships, it spoils our world, and yet despite God's warnings and correction, we continue in our hard-heartedness and pride. So this is a passage, I think, and it's certainly been doing this for me this week. It should humble us to repentance for our Pharaoh-like rebellion against our Maker. It calls us to come before him and to confess that he alone is Lord, to submit our lives to him, because that is the worship this Yahweh deserves from every creature on the planet. With my RI kids on Fridays, I teach them a great song from Colin Buchanan, Jesus is the Mighty, Mighty King. And it's got a very clear line in it. It says, I am not the boss, You are not the boss, They are not the boss, everyone out there in the world, because Jesus is the boss. Jesus is the Mighty, Mighty King. And we need to see that. Even as Christians, once we've given our lives to Christ as our Lord, we need to keep surrendering the control of each area of our life to him. It's good reflecting on what thoughts, sinful thoughts and actions and attitudes that you're being hard-hearted in right now. And if you're seeking true change, true repentance, not the five-minute kind of repentance like Pharaoh, ask for the Spirit to help you turn around, to stop going your own way and start going God's way. Secondly, heed God's warning of judgment. Now, this passage shows us that God keeps his word to judge, just as much as he keeps it to save and bless his people. He always follows through on what he warns. We don't like talking about judgment. It's not my favourite topic at all, but the Bible is very clear that judgment is real. It's the danger all of us are in as the just punishment for our sin. As Romans 6 says, the wages of sin are death. In Hebrews 9, it speaks of how man is destined to die once and after that to face judgment. And we've all seen from these nine plagues, it's a frightening thing to fall into the hands of God and his judgment. We'll all have to give an account of our lives before the throne of Christ at his return. And we don't want to experience the judgment as he deserves. And yet the good news of Christianity, the good news of the gospel, is that in Christ, God has graciously poured out the judgment we deserved on his own son at the cross. Jesus drank the cup of God's wrath that should have been ours. I think John chapter 3 makes it very clear what our response should be. The Father loves the Son and has placed everything in his hands. Whoever believes in the Son has eternal life, but whoever rejects the Son will not see life, for God's wrath remains on them. That's the options. Either we give our judgment to Jesus and accept his free gift of pardon and eternal life, or it remains on us. So that's the second application. We need to heed the warning of God's judgment, come to Christ as our Saviour. And thirdly, I think if we know this truth, if we have embraced Christ as our Saviour, we can rejoice in God's merciful distinction. While this is a horrific part of the Bible, don't miss the mercy of God that's there all the way through. Pharaoh, God could have wiped him out with one word, and yet he's given many chances to repent. The Egyptians, we saw in that reading from the hail plague, if they would listen to the warning and come inside, they would be spared its damage. And those who feared Yahweh did just that, and they were spared along with the Israelites. And of course, again and again through these sections, we see that God makes a distinction between Egypt and Israel, his chosen people. And we see that he treats them just as much as they are sinful. We saw that in Callum's sermon last week. They have a flaky faith. They don't trust God as they should. And yet he treats them with great mercy and grace. And this would have been a confidence builder. As the Israelites read these chapters and saw God's mighty power, it would have given them confidence to trust this God who is on their side. On Saturday mornings, I go down and watch my daughter play netball. And if you've ever been past the Graceville netball courts on a Saturday morning, they are packed. There's netball games going on everywhere. And the thing I've noticed, I'm not a netball expert whatsoever, but if you've got someone tall on your team, well, you're a pretty good chance of success. You just plant them up near the goal area and get the ball to them, and you're a pretty good chance of winning the game. And when you look, if you're on a team like that and you've got someone tall in the goals, what a confidence boost it is to look up and see someone who could win the game for you. That's the effect of these chapters for those who know this God in a personal way, who've come to trust him as Saviour. And we know that in the Lord Jesus, if he has taken our sin, well, this God is, as Romans 8 puts it, on our side. If he is for us, who can be against us? We have a great song that we sing here at Graceville from City of Light. We won't fear the battle. We won't fear the night. We will walk the valley with you by our side. You will go before us. You will lead the way. We have found a refuge only you can save. Sing with joy now. Our God is for us. The Father's love is a strong and mighty fortress. Raise your voice now. No love is greater. Who can stand against us if our God is for us? That's what we rejoice in if we know this Jesus, that God has made a merciful distinction with us, that he is on our side as we face troubles in this life, struggle with sin and suffering and the brokenness of our world. Our God is with us, and he's promised the final victory is coming. He's demonstrated his power in these signs and wonders against Egypt. He's demonstrated his power and love and mercy to us in the Lord Jesus Christ. And so if you belong to his saved people, well, we can rejoice that he does not treat us as our sins deserve, but has instead showered us with mercy. Let's pray, and then we're going to sing about that future day when Jesus' name will be praised by everyone. Let's bow before him. Heavenly Father, we are humbled by the picture of you we receive in these chapters of your word. Father, correct our misunderstandings, and particularly we ask that you would correct our hearts. Often we think that we run our world, that we're in charge, that things are about our glory, and for that we're sorry. Sorry that our hearts are often hard like Pharaoh's, unyielding to your will. Please forgive us. Father, we want to thank you for the Lord Jesus, that he willingly took the judgment we deserved upon himself as he died on the cross for our sins, to set us free from the curse of death. Father, I pray that each of us would turn to him for mercy, that we'd receive his free pardon and escape from the judgment that we deserve. Help us to embrace him as Saviour and rejoice in your merciful distinction towards us. We pray this all for the glory of Jesus, our King. Amen.
I can't say as the musicians come forward and lead us in our closing song, but this last song there, I do need to introduce it to you because it is a wonderful reminder of Rohan's sermon this morning and the things that we've heard about Pharaoh's heart and how he typifies the world, both believers and unbelievers. At the name of Jesus, every knee shall bow. And this is going to happen. You know, it happened in the case of Pharaoh, whether he wanted to and whether he rebelled. In the end, it was God who wins. At the name of Jesus, every knee shall bow. The second coming of Jesus is going to happen. Okay, it's going to happen. And whether you're on the Lord's side or whether you're in rebellion, everyone will bow at that name. So let's stand and sing this last hymn.
At the name of Jesus, every knee shall bow, every tongue confess him, King of glory now. Is the Father's pleasure we should call him Lord, who from the beginning was the mighty Word. Humbled for a season to receive a name from the of sinners unto whom he came. Faithfully he bore it, spotless to the last, brought it back victorious when from death he passed. In your hearts enthrone him, there let him subdue. All that is not holy, all that is not true. Crown him as your captain in temptation's hour. Let his will enfold you with its light and power. Brothers, this Lord Jesus shall return again with his Father's glory, with his angel train. For all wreaths of empire meet upon his brow, and our hearts confess him King of glory.
Brings us to the conclusion of our service, and thank you all for being here this morning. Wonderful to worship together in the Lord. I want to close with the words from Hebrews chapter 13. Now may the God of peace, who brought again from the dead our Lord Jesus Christ, the great shepherd of the sheep, by the blood of the eternal covenant, equip you with everything good that you may do his will, working in us that which is pleasing in his sight, through Jesus Christ, to whom be glory forever and ever. Amen. Please stay for a cup of coffee and fellowship. And also, we've got the congregational meeting there at 12 o'clock.